there. I'm Mickey Mouse. Bet you never had a mailbox talk to you before. Drop me a line sometime.
The Disneyland Limited, now leaving for a grand circle tour of the Magic Kingdom. All passengers board.
Star Tours announces the boarding of the Endor Express. All passengers, please prepare for immediate boarding.
Please stand clear of the doors. Por favor, manténganse alejado de las puertas. To those guests who've just joined us, welcome. For those of you standing, please hold on to the handrails throughout our journey and stay clear of the doors.
Please keep your hands, arms, and legs inside the train and remain seated at all times. Now, hang on to them hats and glasses, because this here's the wildest ride in the wilderness.
I am Sam the American Eagle, and I am proud to introduce the Grand Circle Tour Podcast, a celebration of Disney parks, but mostly the American ones. I really like these guys.
Hello, passengers, and welcome aboard for Adventure 139 of the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. My name is Justin, and I will be the mission commander for this expedition into the unknown. Joining me tonight are my two favorite co-hosts. To my left is our communications officer, Captain Stan Solo. And to my other left is the astro-navigation officer, Conductor Dan. We'll start with you, Stan. How are you tonight, and what's up?
Hey, I'm promoted again. I'm back to captain again. All right. A couple weeks ago, I had a slight demotion. I'm great. It's been a quiet weekend. Not doing much this weekend. Kind of taking it easy. But you know the Disney movie rewards? Yeah, I get those little pins when you buy the movies and all that. So I always get the movie posters. And I've gotten all the Star Wars movie posters over the years from them. And they got rid of them. They don't have the movie posters anymore. They didn't. So right before Skywalker came out, Rise of Skywalker, they didn't have the one for Skywalker. And I guess a lot of people complained, and they're back there now. And I ordered it, and it arrived. Got a frame and hung it up today. So I got every single Star Wars movie poster. Not every single Star Wars movie, but one from each movie. hung in my house somewhere. From the theaters.
Cool. That is awesome.
Yeah.
I have, from the original trilogy, I have a poster for each movie hanging in my hallway just outside my office here.
Yeah, it's nice when you see the three of them together like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. My original trilogy ones are not original posters. I did have the original Empire Strikes Back one from the theater that was given to me as a kid by a guy that owned the theater. Of course, my dad burnt it as soon as I left. But I bought replicas of those three. But all the other ones are actual movie posters.
That's awesome. So how about you, Dan? How are you tonight? And what's up with you?
Hey, guys. I feel like the three of us just did a show like 3 weeks ago. Is that right? Weird how that works. If we were efficient, we would have recorded them both at the same time. But
you know. Yeah, okay. We could have had a weekend off.
What's up with me? Well, I sent the picture to you guys, but I'll tell the passengers. This weekend we bought our family PJs. We do the corny family PJs every year. Usually it's just like, you know, Frosty PJs or Santa PJs or whatever. But the four of us this year, we went and we found the coolest family PJs. Which ones are they? Baby Yoda, baby.
The greatest thing to come out of 2020.
I know, right?
Oh, absolutely.
So yeah. I was very, very excited about those. Usually I'm not too excited about the family PJ thing, but this year I was very happy.
Awesome. How about you, Justin?
That is awesome. Well, let's see. What's up with me? I am very excited to hear that the Muppets are coming back to Liberty Square at Disney World.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you hear that?
I saw some videos of it.
I have not seen the video yet. I got to check that out.
It's kind of... Go ahead, Justin.
No, go ahead.
It's kind of awkward. Did you see the videos? Well, they don't speak. There's no show. They just randomly come out.
What do you mean they don't speak?
They just kind of mime and mimic and do little bits without speaking.
I thought it was
people
like a...
down in the crowd, like they yell out their name and they wave back to the person in the crowd. And but this, it's not a show. It's not a set show.
No, I thought it was like a Christmas thing. I guess not.
Yeah, it's great. They have Christmas banners and whatnot. Okay. And they put down. Or maybe what I saw was just a preview. Maybe there's going to be a show. Justin, do you know more about it?
You know, I don't know a lot more about it. I was just excited to see that it was going to be there. And I thought for sure that they were doing a show. I assumed that they would just, you know, get the voice actors to do a new show. And they obviously have the puppets there for the cast members to run. But it sounds,
yeah, it looked like they just had
it sounds like maybe they're doing it almost more like a socially distanced meet and greet kind of thing.
That's what it seemed like.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like Miss Piggy was posing and weaving her hair around, and the cast member is there kind of talking like on the ground, like about like sort of explaining what they're doing. Yeah. It was kind of weird. Maybe they'll change it up. Maybe they'll fix it. Maybe they'll get recordings that they could use or something. I don't know, but.
You know, a couple months ago, I was over at Sesame Place, which for those passengers that don't know what that is, but it's a Sesame Street amusement park run by SeaWorld in Pennsylvania. And, you know, you walk down, it looks like Sesame Street, right? And I couldn't help but notice, and it was probably because of COVID and everything, that they totally ripped off Liberty Square, where they just cut holes in the windows on the top of Sesame Street. And Elmo and, you know, Bert and Ernie, they are out on the windows just like Liberty Square is with the Muppets. But okay. I've been going to Sesame Place for a while now with the kids, and that never happened before. So
definitely. What would they do before? They would have like meet and greets?
Yeah, meet and greets. Yeah, exactly. So
okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's what it seemed. It seemed like it was like a meet and greet from a distance.
Yep.
Without them talking.
It makes sense, you know?
Yeah.
Well, like but I say, I mean, we know they have those puppets, so it's good to use them. And I'm, like I said, I'm just happy to see the Muppets back. I always like to see the Muppets.
Yeah.
Sure.
Now, what I heard from one of the people that saw the Muppets is that they're a little bit bigger than the actual Muppets.
Hmm.
Like they probably Kermit's, have to be because they're so far away.
Because of the height, yeah. Like Kermit's head is bigger than your hand would normally be.
But is it the same Muppets they used for the Great Moments in History?
It sure looks like it.
Okay.
Yeah, I would assume so.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
That's
because I've seen that show and I don't really remember it being too big, but I don't know.
Well, maybe you're far away
from my perspective, so, right?
From exactly. Perspective, yeah. Yeah. Yep. There are, he said that they're a little bigger than normal Muppets would be. They're like Miss Piggy's head is quite huge to operate and whatnot. Yeah.
I suppose a combination of being that far away plus the forced perspective mm-hmm. on the building itself.
Sure.
If they were normal size, they would look too small.
Yeah. That's the way I understood it.
Yeah, that's very
interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Well, passengers, tonight we are trying something a little different. We are doing sort of a grab bag of listener email questions. We're going to go around and each one of us is going to read some of these emails that we have received or questions that we have received from our various listeners from around the world and around the galaxy. And we'll do our best to answer them. This is the first time we've tried this, so apologies in advance if things are a little rough.
So some of the emails are very, very, very old. Is that what we're saying? Since we haven't answered any of them.
Well, we're getting warnings that our email box is too full.
Questions now.
So. Yeah, our email box is too full. We had to do something about it. So we figured, why not start reading them on the air?
So with that, I believe Stan had a little intro he was going to start things off with for us.
There we go.
We got such a high budget. It's unbelievable.
Our official jingle for the email shows.
Speaking of budgets, I can't tell you how many people commented on your opening for the live show, Stan, saying how great it was.
It was a fun intro. Yeah.
Yeah. Very good job.
Thank you.
That one is awesome. So let's start off with you, Stan. This was your idea to do this. So let's start with you and you get to read out the first question.
Sure. Yeah. Like I said, our email box is getting overflowing. We got to delete some of them. So let's start answering these. My first one is from Todd in Minnesota. He says, "Hi, I love the show. With the new mask wearing rules, are we permitted to remove our masks and eat on the Magical Express?" Is what Todd wants to know. Because as you know, we have to wear our masks at any public place at Disney World, except for, you know, a few limited spots. You guys know the answer to this one?
Maybe we should have read the questions before I got the actual answers.
Okay. I actually know the answer to this one.
All right, good.
The Disney ruling is you are not permitted to eat on any Disney transportation, including Magical Express.
Yeah.
So you're not allowed to bring food and drink on the buses, on the monorails, the Skyliner. You can bring it, but you can't eat it on the bus. And same thing goes for like Magical Express. So no, you can't eat on the Magical Express because you're not supposed to. You can't remove your mask on the Magical Express. The only places in the Disney bubble on Disney property you can remove your mask is when you're eating in a designated spot.
Which no longer is a queue, by the way. In the beginning, I think you could eat in a queue, but now you can't.
That's correct. Yeah, no, it has to be. Yeah, it doesn't. And you can't be walking and eating. When you're swimming, you're permitted to remove your mask, or in the relaxation zone. Those are pretty much the three spots. So that was an easy one.
Cool. That was an easy one. And you went from newest to oldest, obviously. I went oldest to newest.
Don't yeah, I kind of just randomly grabbed ones that seemed interesting and I just grabbed a couple.
Well, Dan, let's go on to you then. What is the question you have for us?
All right. I got one. I'm gonna skip the beginning because then you'll know how old these emails really are. So
let's is just there a get prize with the part. For the oldest email in
the book? Well, let's just say this person is planning a trip next summer and I'm pretty sure that trip didn't happen because of COVID.
Okay. Anyway,
we could still answer the question. Basically, it says, planning on going for 7 days next summer. 2 days, however, will just be travel, leaving 5 full days. I want to do 1 day in each park with 1 rest day. What order do you suggest? Ashley from Lexington, Kentucky. So, I don't know what you guys think, but I would first say that I'd probably put that rest day right smack in the middle.
Yeah, 100%, I agree.
Day 3. And what I personally do, I mean, this is how I always plan my trips. And I know, Stan, you're going to have probably a little different answer because you're kind of a just go where the wind takes you type of guy. But I use touring plans and I check to see what the busiest days of the year or busiest days of my trip are. And then from there, I see if maybe Epcot is a little busier on Tuesday compared to Wednesday and stuff like that. And I try to figure it out so that I can get to a park with the least amount of crowds. Now with COVID, it's a little different, because we know what's going on with the capacity with that. But I'm talking about under normal circumstances. That's kind of how I plan my day. To me, it doesn't really matter if I save Magic Kingdom for the end or if I do it first. I know a lot of people like to do that stuff, and you may have your own family traditions as well. But if you're really just trying to figure out, what the best order is, my opinion is find out what the least amount of crowds are and use that to your advantage. What do you guys think?
One tip I would say, very quick way to find out to see that a park is maybe going to be a little more busy that day is check the opening magic hours, the morning.
Yeah.
If they have morning magic hours, that park's going to be more busy that day. So that's maybe you want to avoid that park that day.
Yeah. And I, for myself, I try not to do Magic Kingdom on a Sunday or a Monday because most people hit Magic Kingdom first and their trip will usually start on a Sunday or a Monday. And that's which one they're going to go to. So I try to do Magic Kingdom like on a Tuesday because that's usually your busiest park. That's switching though, because nowadays Hollywood Studios is your busiest park.
Yeah.
People are saying that's when people will. But I think traditionally people still go to Magic Kingdom first. I think Hollywood Studios is busier, but they do it still later in the week.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. Maybe do Hollywood Studios first.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I like to do Magic Kingdom last because we'll usually go there at least twice on a trip anyway. Yeah. And so the last day, it's always nice to kind of finish in the Magic Kingdom park.
See, I used to do that. If I was doing only 5 days, I would do Magic Kingdom twice. But the last trip I went on, we did Hollywood Studios twice. Magic Kingdom only once.
I suppose it does change the dynamics a little bit Galaxy's Edge there. Mm-hmm. I haven't been able to be there since they've opened Galaxy's Edge, so I wouldn't know that yet.
You haven't done Smuggler's Run yet?
No.
Oh my gosh. I didn't realize that.
I was going to go this May.
Holy cow. Okay. Well, we're going to go in November. You're coming with us.
November, like this month?
No, like a year from now.
Oh, okay. That's a long time from now.
Well, I got to wait for the border to open first.
Oh, yeah, that's right. The whole Canadian thing.
Yeah, and the 2 week, all that, yeah. Okay, Justin, do you have a letter?
All right. Well, this one, I'm just going to skip over a lot of the letter part of it here. But Henry asks, what with all of the changes that have happened in the movie schedule, what is the movie's release schedule nowadays?
That's the magic question.
When is Black Widow going to come out, for example? So I did look at this ahead of time. So we do have, obviously, the first thing up now is Soul is going to come out on Disney Plus here
Christmas Day, I believe, right?
Christmas time. Christmas Day, yeah.
Oh, it's Christmas Day. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, okay. Christmas Day, Soul's coming out.
Oh, wow.
I guess that's in lieu of the parade on Christmas Day. You can all watch Soul instead.
That's not happening.
Going to theaters now, it's going straight to Disney Plus, and it's not doing the premium pricing like they did with Mulan either.
Mm-hmm.
After that, then we've got Raya and the Last Dragon is coming out in March of 2021. And Black Widow has been pushed out now to May 7th of 2021.
So far.
May of 2020 or 2021, I mean, is Cruella. And then in June is Luca. In July, we've got Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings, which is another Marvel one.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Oh, Justin, can I interrupt you quickly?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, so that Kim's, for people that listen to the Mandalorian show we recorded this week, the actor that plays Kim on Kim's Convenience, the one that's playing the Shang,
mm-hmm.
He plays the son of the guy from Kim's Convenience.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. So it's pretty cool. They got a couple Canadian kids in the coming up for Disney actors. Just something I was proud of to see. I love that show, Kim's Convenience. If you're here to get a chance to watch it, you should.
I'm gonna have to check that one out now. You've spoken very highly of it on a couple of these shows now.
Yeah.
Okay, so next up we've got Jungle Cruise has been pushed out now to July 30th.
Do you know that Jungle Cruise was supposed to be premiering? I was supposed to be watching that on my actual cruise. I was so excited. My cruise that was supposed to be in last July. That was the movie coming out, and it's going to be pushed back a whole year. That's insane.
You might be watching it on your second cruise at the rate it's going.
Probably. If I even get on a second cruise.
And the next movie on my list here is one that we were supposed to be reviewing this month, and that's Eternals.
And right.
This was pushed out to November of next year.
Wow. Yeah. What a crazy year.
Behind all of this is.
Wow.
Then that'll be followed in December by Spider-Man, whatever we're calling this one, Spider-Man 3.
do we know the
name of that one yet?
What was the first one? Homecoming? Oh, no.
It was Homecoming, then Far From Home, and this one's going to be Homeroom. I don't know. Something
home
like
run.
That. Home run. Yeah.
Spider-Man, home run. He'll be playing the New York Yankees all by himself.
We have to do a show just of the rumors of Spider-Man 3. Man.
There's no place like home. Okay.
Yeah,
he'll clip his ruby spider web feet together.
Have you guys heard the rumors about the new Spider-Man? Have you been keeping up with it?
I know that his friend has lost a lot of weight since the last time.
Oh, Ned?
Yeah. Yeah.
But have you heard about the signings and like what the supposed plot is, and it's going to be a multiverse, and they're trying to get Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire signed, which some say are already signed.
That rumor, I guess I hadn't paid much attention to it because I try not to pay too much attention to that kind of thing. Cause I like to go in to these movies as much as without any knowledge as much.
Yeah,
as
I gotcha.
Not Dan.
I'm opposite. I look up every night to see if there's more updates.
Dan checks touring plans to see what all the what's the best day to go and. Oh, that's amazing how these movies. Wow, what a jeez, Louise. Eh?
Well, yeah, I mean they've had this whole schedule in place for so long, and now it's all out the window. Everything's pushed back. I mean, we don't get like Thor or Doctor Strange until like 2022 now. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They've all been pushed out. Guardians of the Galaxy 3, I couldn't even find a release date for that anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's where we are with that whole movie schedule. It's kind of crazy.
It's interesting for sure.
All right, Stan, do you have another letter for us? Another listener email question?
Yeah, this one says, with the COVID restrictions, and I haven't got all the COVID questions. With the COVID restrictions in place, are refillable popcorn buckets still available? Thank you for all you do, Amy in New Jersey.
So the refillable popcorn buckets.
I mean, did you guys get the refillable popcorn buckets? Is this something?
This is a Stan Solo question, definitely. This is why we gave it to you.
Yes, yeah. This is a question meant for me. Yes, the popcorn buckets are still available. In fact, the holiday one came out this week, I believe, the holiday popcorn bucket. Do you guys get the popcorn at all at Disney? Is it a must-do for you?
I get the popcorn, but I'm not obsessed with the buckets like everyone else is.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Justin?
Yeah, I don't tend to get the popcorn very much, mostly because I don't do a lot of snacking.
Yeah.
I'm usually more focused on getting to from this attraction to the next attraction.
Yeah, fair enough. So the changes though is you basically just show your bucket, and the cast member won't take it from you. They'll just give you a cardboard one, like a new one, a new cardboard one, and you can dump it into your bucket yourself. Which okay. I love this. I wish it was like that all the time, because I prefer that over them handling my bucket and whatnot. Just for whatever reason, and putting it into the, you know, the popcorn or scooping it. It's just, I never was happy with the way they did it before. And I would often just ask them, can I just have it in cardboard anyways? And he would do it for me in the past.
Right.
So, yeah. Huh. Simple.
They do the same thing on the cruises with, if you get the beer package, they give you, you get to keep the pint glass, or I think it's a little larger than a pint, but you don't have to actually carry the pint glass. They give you a coin in return, and then you keep the coin in your pocket.
I wish they would do that with the popcorn buckets on the cruises, because you have to have your popcorn bucket with you on the cruise, which is a pain to carry around. And then they don't want to go back. But it's the same price, whether you get a refill on your bucket or whether you get, I thought it was, someone told me it isn't. I don't know.
But anyways, for the beer or for the popcorn?
For the popcorn.
Oh, okay.
They have the popcorn buckets on the cruises as well.
Because the beer is cheaper. It's if you refill the beer, it's a, you know,
it is cheaper too with the popcorn buckets. But I don't like carrying it around all day when I go to the movie or whatever on the cruise. Yeah. I can't plan that far ahead. I go down. My room is two stories down. I got to go all the way there for popcorn.
All right. If Stan's been mumbling about the popcorn buckets.
Yeah. Hey, Dan.
All right. This one's from Joe T in Portland, which I'm not sure if it's Oregon or Maine. But anyway, he goes on. He talks a little bit in the beginning about his restaurants. He says that he's a big believer that ambiance is just as important as food is to make a restaurant good. That being said, what's your favorite restaurants on purely ambiance alone? In Disney,
that's still open.
Well, I think this was pre-COVID, so let's answer this. Assuming COVID never happened.
No,
I got a couple. I mean, first thing I think of is California Grill. I think that's great, right? I like the ambiance of. I'm a big fan of the Wilderness Lodge, so anything over there I like. I love the new outdoor bar area in the Wilderness Lodge, all that type of stuff. What do you guys think? You have any ideas?
Go ahead, Justin.
You know, I like the Jungle Cruise theme one, although I haven't eaten there yet. Mm-hmm. The Skipper's Canteen.
Yep.
I mean, I love that the whole look of all of that. So that's one that I would say. I also like Be Our Guest, the Beauty and the Beast castle, because it just feels like you're in that castle.
Yeah.
So those are two that come to my mind immediately of ones that are in the park.
Another one that I love is Ohana, just because of the view that you see. You know, you see all of Magic Kingdom in the background.
See, yeah, I'm taking it from a different perspective. I'm thinking like I'm 12. So, so I'm thinking Rainforest Cafe, Dinosaur, Hollywood Studios. What's the Planet Hollywood?
Brown Derby?
Planet Hollywood. No, like you're thinking more like the relaxing. I'm thinking more energetic, you know, family, kids running around.
You're over listening to Sunny Eclipse.
yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I guess it depends what type of ambiance you want. If you want that's more hectic, like I don't normally eat at Rainforest Cafe type of place, or if you want the quieter, you know, make sense?
Sure. Yeah, no, it totally makes sense. Totally makes sense.
Yeah. So it depends what type of ambiance you're looking for.
I'll give you an example, like Coral Reef. Personally, mm-hmm. personally, I think the food's terrible. Like, that's just my opinion.
Yeah.
But like, it's really cool, right? It's like pretty awesome to look at the, you know, at all the fish and, you know, be facing the aquarium the whole time.
I've never eaten at the Edison. I think Edison has a pretty cool look to it. Boathouse is another one that has great food and is, you know, stuff to look at. On the walls, basically.
And the Boathouse, I mean, I think Boathouse is one of my favorites because it has the great ambiance and it has amazing food too.
Yeah. And it's in your favorite park.
Correct. Exactly. Which, by the way, I have a question on coming soon.
Oh, cool.
I picked that one.
All right. Well, we look forward Justin. To that one. All right. Next up, Brad asks us, says a group of us are planning to go down to Walt Disney World, but one of the people in our group doesn't like roller coasters and other fast moving rides like that. What sort of rides and attractions would you recommend for this person? So
that's my question. I know
Stan would have some input on.
Yeah, anything that drops, spins, falls, or twists or goes too fast, you want to avoid.
So, what does that leave, I think, is what Brad is asking us.
Well, I think Magic Kingdom, you could do just about everything.
Most of Fantasyland, certainly.
Except for Spaceship Earth, soon to be Tron, Splash Mountain, and Big Thunder Mountain are the ones that I don't do. I don't want to do Seven Dwarfs ever again. Not that I am afraid of it or I get sick of it or whatever. Just to me, it's not worth it. I don't enjoy those rides. And same thing with the Goofy coaster. What's it called?
Barnstormer.
There you go. Yeah, I did Barnstormer.
I just think of it as the Goofy coaster.
Yeah. I keep calling it the Great Goofini for some reason. Yeah, so that's Magic Kingdom. Hollywood Studios, Tower of Terror, Rock and Roller Coaster, Star Tours.
And to be clear, listeners, these are the ones we're avoiding here.
Yes. So those are the three I don't do. Oh, and Toy Story, Slinky Dog Coaster. Epcot, what's it? Well, it'll be Guardians of the Galaxy soon. I won't be doing that.
Yeah, you probably, yeah, that one's going to be a roller coaster, but you can do things like Living with the Land and Soarin'.
Yeah, Soarin' I can do. I think that's about it. I've never done Test Track, but I know I could.
I think you could do that one. It's
I know I could.
Not really. Dips or drops or whatever.
Yeah, like the Cars one in Disneyland. I've done that a couple of times and it's fine.
Yeah, and Test Track is going to be kind of like that as well.
Yeah. And Spaceship Earth I've never done. Or Mission Space, rather.
Mission Space. You've probably done Spaceship Earth.
Yeah, Spaceship Earth. I love Spaceship Earth. It needs to be updated, but I still love it. Hollywood Studios. We did that already. Animal Kingdom, Expedition Everest.
Yeah, that one's another roller coaster to avoid. But
Well,
Animal Kingdom in particular, there's just so many, like the walking trails and such. I mean, you can spend a whole day there and not have to worry about going on any sort of dropping sort of ride.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the shows are no longer running. So hopefully they're back sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
I enjoy the shows more than I do the attractions, actually.
I really, really like the Finding Nemo one there in particular.
Mm-hmm.
That whole musical.
Yeah. Well, in every park, I like the shows more than the attractions. Except for Rise of Resistance and Smuggler's Run and Toy Story Midway Mania.
But so now you, my top three. You are able to do the, like, Smuggler's Run and Rise of the Resistance, and that those are fine.
Yeah. So if you get nauseous easy or movement or heights is a thing for you, which is like I have every checkbox marked, I can't do any of those. Yeah, I can do Smuggler's Run and Rise of Resistance, no problem.
Okay. Well, say that's good to know, because I know Star Tours is kind of a motion ride.
Star Tours I can't do
with that, but Smuggler's Run is okay then.
Yeah. I did Star Tours and I really shouldn't have. We'll just leave it at that.
All right. Well, I think we've answered that question. So, Stan, do you have another one? I made you work for mine.
Yeah. No kidding. You could answer this one then. With the current booking system, if once we are there, can we change a day? For example, we're going for 6 days. This is kind of like Dan's first email he got. We're going for 6 days, but we're only getting 5 park tickets, so they're planning on having a day off. So if day two it's pouring rain, can we cancel that day and make day three a reservation day?
So we're saying like we have reservations at a restaurant and we want to switch to a different.
No, the reservations at a park. The current reservation system's at the park. Oh. So they have reservations on day 1, 2, then 3 is a break, and then 4 and 5 are all park days. But day 2 it's raining. They don't want to go to the park. They want to make that a break day. And then make day 3 a park day. Can they cancel day 2 and make day 3 a park day?
You know, I don't know the answer to that, but I assume I'm guessing you could, but would you need to know that in advance? Like, I'm not sure you could do it that morning.
Let's finish here. Thank you for very much. I'm really enjoying the show. Jim doesn't say where he's from. The answer to that is yes, you can. As long as you haven't entered the park yet. You can't go into a park and say, you know what, I don't want to go now. And then cancel. You could cancel and you can book as long as there's days available. So if you're day 3, which you haven't booked yet, if there's an opening at a park, you can go on the calendar and you won't be able to book it because you don't have a ticket for it because you already have other ones. But you could cancel one. Just make sure before you cancel that the day you have open there's actual
available.
Yeah, that there's available. Is what you
do. And you know, Florida weather, I mean, most of the time it rains during the day, but if you do get by chance a storm in the morning, everyone's going to be doing the same thing, right?
So do it quickly.
and make sure that there's something else available before you do it.
Yeah. So you're kind of taking a bit of a chance, but yeah, it should be, you can do it though. Technically you can.
Right.
Personally, I'd probably just throw in a poncho and go anyway.
Yeah, because chances are in Florida, unless it's a hurricane, it's going to clear up eventually, and you're gonna get some sun out there.
It depends. Some days it rains all day, and you know it's going to rain all day. But anyways, go ahead, Dan.
All right, yeah, you're up next.
All right, I'm gonna jump over to that. Where is that one? About my favorite park, Disney Springs. Here it is. Hi, GCT. I know Dan loved staying at Saratoga because you can walk to the springs to hang out every night. Here's my question. What exactly do you mean by hang out? What are some of your favorite hangout spots? Tyler from Arizona. So I thought this was a great question. We probably don't talk about this a lot. And I, to be honest with you, I don't know if Justin, if Stan, if you guys quote unquote hang out there or if you just go out to eat there. But I do a lot of hanging out because I usually stay at Saratoga and instead of going to my room, I go to Disney Springs and hang out there. So I'll give you a couple things that pops into my head. If you want to just do like a bar and get a drink or something, even if you just want to just go to a bar and hang out, you don't even have to drink. I think Jock Lindsey's is such an awesome place. It's got the Adventurers Club feel to it. They actually have some props from the Adventurers Club there. Just a really cool place. Some really funky drinks. They give you different glasses, you know, and things like that. Fun place. Worth your time to just go hang out.
You know, I've never been to Jocks, but I think that you could add that to your list as a great place for ambiance too.
Yeah, exactly. Good.
I think, yeah.
Definitely.
From my previous
list, they only have like little light, you know, bar food type stuff. So it's not like really a restaurant.
Right.
It is a cool place to hang out. I think, you know, this, they have some of the art places, just to walk through and look at the art. I do that. I think I've told the story on the show before how maybe one time I spent too much time at Jock Lindsay's and then went to the art shop and didn't realize how much money I spent in the art shop. So don't do it that way. Do the art shop first.
No, you go to the Lego store.
Yeah, the Lego store, you know, stores, places like that. I always hang out in the Lego store, the Christmas shop. I always pop into there and hang out. That the little bridge, there's like that little bridge through one of the springs. I guess that's what they call it, over the water. They have these little like pop-up shops and they have like different things. You know, they have like a thing on like a booth with like plants and I don't know, stuff like that. It's just pretty cool to walk around and, you know, take in the feels while you could sit there and have a little drink. There's actually a little, I guess you could call it stage area. I think it's outside of, it's outside of Wine Bar George around that area. And they usually have a band playing there with people sitting around, you know, dancing and singing. And
there's always something going on, like the piano, moving piano.
The traveling piano guy.
Yeah.
I don't even go that deep into it. I don't even go near like the shops. I just stay on that one end. And usually there's so much to do that, you know, next thing I know, it's too late and I have to go back to the hotel, you know.
the Marvel store is something I always check out because I like, as well as the Star Wars store.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, there's lots to do at Disney Springs.
I miss when we did have Adventurers Club, because that was always a place that I loved to go hang out. I would hang out there as long as they would let me.
We got to do a show on the Adventurers Club because, you know, I Adventurers Club was a, in between my years of like not of like falling out of Disney, like, you know, when I was a kid, I couldn't go. I didn't really go to Disney for about a couple of years. And then when I got back into Disney, Adventurers Club was closed. So maybe I'd do a show on that one day.
How about you, Justin?
All right. So next question here. Stan from Winnipeg asks me, what's your favorite Disney Plus show and why is it The Mandalorian?
Love it.
But more seriously, what's other than The Mandalorian, what other Disney Plus shows would you recommend to people if they were going to get it, if they don't already have the have Disney Plus? And
well, okay. For me, Prop Culture is probably the second best show of all the Disney Plus originals.
I love that one and the Imagineering
story. Imagineering, yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I love about Disney Plus is that after, like, if you just watch those two shows to start, then you have that one line on your Disney Plus that says shows you may like, right? Yeah. And I always find myself going to that, and like it because it knows me. And then you could find things like the One Day at Disney show, which I probably wouldn't have watched until I saw it that popped up there. There's that Animal Kingdom show. I don't even know what the name of it is, but
I've been watching that one. I love that show. That is one of my favorites right now.
Yeah, and that's one that, like I said, I probably wouldn't have watched unless it popped up on the You May Like This.
Actually, that one popped up on mine. That's why I watched that one as well. Yeah. It was the Animal Kingdom. But the rest of mine are all Muppet ones all the way across. It's like all the Muppet movies, Muppet Take Manhattan, Muppet's Great Cup, Muppet Caper, Muppets Now, all the ones. Those are all mine all come up as.
That's funny.
The Forky shorts are really good, too.
I've been a lot of Star Wars because I've been watching the Clone Wars lately.
Yeah,
the Forky shows, excuse me, I have, so my two-year-old, he was just starting to talk.
Stan and your two-year-old.
Yeah, exactly. He's just starting to talk. One of his first words.
Trash?
Is... I don't know. And he says it like that. He says, I don't know. So when I say, Liam, did you do that? Like if like there's a spilt milk or something, Liam, did you do that? And he goes, I don't know. It's so cute.
Oh, man. That's funny. All right. Okay. Am I up?
You're up.
Okay. I think Dan's going to answer this one. He goes, hey, gang. So they wrote it. What is George like in real life? Paul in Florida.
It's terrible. Next question.
Paul wants to know, what is George like?
I'm going to guess troublemaker. Just
troublemaker. George is the troublemaker of the group.
Okay.
No, I mean, listen, George and I love George. So our on air rivalry is just a shtick. You know, it's not real. But George is a great guy. He's definitely the youngest out of all of us, right? I mean, that's the one thing I would say about George is that, you know, we're all middle-aged people, and George is definitely, God, it's probably by 10 years, all of us, right?
But I think I'm the second oldest after Chris.
Yeah. So he's the youngster of the group, but he's, you know, we all love George.
And George is like a real diehard, true Disney fan, too.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, I think when I joined this podcast and I met all you guys, I thought I was the biggest diehard Disney fan ever. Then I met you guys, and I'm like, whoa.
Wow, was I wrong? Okay, Dan.
All right, yeah.
Me, all right. Here's a quick one. We'll go around the room for this one. This one, love the show, blah, 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 blah. Then it says, curious to know, what's everyone's favorite land in the Magic Kingdom? So I'll start. I think I've said this before, but Frontierland is my favorite. Always has been, always will be. Just something about Frontierland that makes me happy. It's my first memory of Disney is Frontierland. Something about the shooting arcade. I don't know. But Tom Sawyer Island, I just love that area. What about you guys? Justin, what do you think?
See, I've always loved the idea of Tomorrowland, and especially when I can go to like the Carousel of Progress. I've got Space Mountain. I'm going to have Tron there pretty soon.
Yep.
We have the People Mover, I guess Tomorrowland Transit Authority, technically speaking. There's so much there, and I love the theming of this sort of this vision of tomorrow. I love that whole concept.
See, before I went to Disney World, I was convinced in my mind that Tomorrowland would be my favorite, but I dig Adventureland. We did the show about it a couple weeks back, and hands down, that's my favorite land.
That was the show with the three of us.
Yeah. We could have done this one right after.
You know, it's funny. Three of us, and we all have three different answers. Isn't that funny?
It is funny. Yeah, no kidding. It is weird.
So, I mean, I guess it's just, you know, everyone has their favorites. And, you know, I think I could be wrong here, but I would think most people's favorite is probably Fantasyland, at least younger people. You know, but it's funny how different people like different things.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Justin, this is your last one.
All right. Yeah, we're coming up toward the end here. So I'm going to ask this one last one. This one comes from Monica, and she asks, when will the Grand Circle podcast group be going to Tokyo Disneyland?
Oof.
It's possible. I wanted to go in May, but people talked me out of it.
We totally have to go to Tokyo sometime, Stan.
Yeah. I think we have to. If not, I don't know. Next year seems like an impossibility, but geez, I'd love to go next year.
It's one of the few parks I haven't been to yet, and I would love to go there. That sounds like an amazing, amazing place.
Yeah, it's my number one.
I want to go with you guys. I think that next year's probably out for me, at least. I think I have a lot of catching up to do with stuff that I didn't do this summer.
Yeah, I feel the same way.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to have to do my cruise. I'm definitely going to have to do at least a week in the summer, you know, in the parks and...
And then 2022, I got Star Wars Celebration and D23 Expo the same year in 2022.
Yeah.
So that's not looking good either. So I don't know.
We've got so many things have all piled up because we didn't get to go this year.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. It's going to be tough. Well, you know what? I got probably about 15 more pages of letters. We're going to have to continue this another day, guys.
Absolutely. Can I read one more?
Yeah.
We have time for one more? All right. Okay. This is the last one I had here. So, hey guys, blah, blah, blah. Going to stay at the beach club next year. Blah, sorry. I try to cut these. Some of these are like four pages long, these emails. So going to stay at the Beach Club next year and plan on eating dinners exclusively in the World Showcase, I guess, because of the entrance there. What do you recommend? So World Showcase only dinners. This is James P. in Long Island, my neighbor. Hey, James.
Oh, boy.
What do I recommend?
Personally, I go over to England and I just get a fish and chips and I'm happy.
Listen, that would definitely be a must do. Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. And the thing is, with the World Showcase, you can't go wrong. I mean, geez, I mean, yeah, pick a different one each day if you want, right? I mean,
yeah.
Some of my favorites personally. I mean, I love Chefs de France. I think if you're into German food, Beer Garden is always a fun time. Mm-hmm. The one in Mexico is great. Love that one.
Yeah.
You know, La Cellier is good. Yeah, I don't know. You can't really go wrong.
I think one of my favorites was Tokyo Dining. It was one of my favorites I had. And La Cellier was also very, very good as well. As well as the Mexico. I don't think I've eaten at many of them now that I think about it. I've done China, Japan, Mexico, Canada. First table service.
Yeah.
I haven't done Marrakesh yet.
No, I haven't done Marrakesh. And what's the other one? And there's three of them in the Japan Pavilion now.
I don't know all
that. Godzilla Grill or something? I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah. There's like this. You can't go wrong on pretty much any of them. They're all great.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering if, what was his name? Les?
James.
James? I hope he realized he can't park hop because I think he's planning on taking the Skyliner from the Beach Club.
Well, considering the date of this email, I don't think that was.
Oh, okay. So this is the last year's email. You got all the old ones. Okay.
We didn't get to last year. So we're working our way through all of these older emails. So as we're getting caught up here, listeners, if you do have any questions, you can always send them to us at gctpodcast@gmail.com, and we'll probably do some more of these shows in the future to answer your questions as well.
Yeah, I mean, the good news, Justin, is if you guys send your email in tonight, we'll probably get to it in the next 3 or 4 years.
Yeah, you never know.
Yeah.
5 years from now, we might be reading your letter on the air.
Exactly. So, they're piling up. We got to deal with these things, guys.
Yeah, but we're coming up on our spaceport here. So as we finish up our docking procedures, take it away, Ken.
If you would like to keep the adventure going after the show, be sure to like our Facebook friends page, Grand Circle Tours Magical Ticket Holders. While you're on Facebook, like our group page, Grand Circle Tours. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Grand Circle Tours Podcast, as well as on Instagram, GCT Podcast, and our YouTube channel, Grand Circle Tour. If you would like to email us, drop us a line at gctpodcast@gmail.com. T-shirts and other fun merchandise can be found at tpublic.com. Simply search Grand Circle Tour Podcast. If you enjoyed your adventure, leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. Only one rule, make it good. All logos, sounds, songs, and music that are made by and for Disney and its affiliates are the full ownership of the Disney Corporation and are not, nor are they intended to be, the ownership of the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. Thank you for riding with us, and welcome home.
Please exit to your left by stepping away from the cars with your left foot first. Step out and stand on the moving platform, please.
Please exit by stepping away from the cars with your left foot first. Step out and stand on the moving platform, please.